Okay, well, welcome. It's good to be with everybody. My name is Lisa Tewksbury. I work at the University of Rhode Island, and I've been here working on 35 years. And since 1994, I've been managing the university's biological control laboratory. And we work primarily with biocontrol of invasive weeds, but we have also done some projects with introduced insects. And so today we're going to focus on the weeds. And starting by sort of showing you, we have this little inconspicuous lab attached to the back of our greenhouse facility, which has been great because everything I work with has to do with plants. So I need the greenhouse. And this is a USDA certified facility. So we have to be inspected periodically. In the beginning, it was every year. Now it's when they think it's necessary or when I apply for a new permit. But all of the specifications of the facility were developed to keep the insects in, and we have to use an autoclave to sterilize insects, plants, things, you know, before they can go out of the facility. So it was devised to be very safe. And the intent of it was to practice what's called classical biological control. And classical involves something like, you know, a new weed that comes in, which is what we're going to talk about today. And the first thing you have to do is find out that there's something, some natural enemy in its native range that you can research to determine if it could help us manage that here. So that's the first step. Then, you know, you could find many insects, but maybe they don't actually have a positive impact on managing the host plant population. So that's the second critical step. And then a lot of times what you want to do it says abroad, meaning in the native range, you do some host range or host specificity work. Some of that is by literature review, you know, what insects feed on which plants, you know, how broad is their host range or how specific is it. Otherwise, you can do some of that work in quarantine in North America, which is what we do here. So I'm giving you a quick rundown on a older biological control of weeds project that we were, it was our first project. Back in 1996, we started this. And we were not doing the initial research on this. We were just doing the implementation of a project that had been brought to the U.S. by Baron Blossi, had been at CABI, a facility in Switzerland, and had done this work. And then he came to be a faculty member at Cornell. And so we had been approached actually by someone in Rhode Island who was the horticulturalist at the Roger Williams Park Zoo. And they have a wetland area there where they introduced the public to some of our natural wetland plants and animals. And they were disturbed that this plant was taking over the wetland. It wasn't, it was filling in the open water area and filling in all along the shore. And so this is just a little bit of a rundown. Says the height is 3 to 6 feet tall. I am 5 feet tall. I swear that some of these plants are 7 or 8 feet tall. One of the biggest things is that the seeds from one plant can be over 2.5 million. So when you have that in the seed bank, it can be very hard to get rid of. So they found many insects in Europe that were feeding and helping to manage purple loosestrife there, but these were the three species that were focused on early on, and it was done in a way to hit various niches on the plant. So the nanopheres up in the upper left is a seed feeder, the Gallerosella over on the upper right is a leaf feeder, and Hylobius in the middle on the left is a root feeder. And so a root feeder, as you can imagine, might have the most likelihood to really kill plants, but enough defoliation can also, after a period of time, impact the plant. And of course, with that 2.5 million seeds per plant, it's great to knock back the seeds as well. So what we specifically released in the zoo, at least in the very beginning, and our greatest effort was put into this leaf feeder, Gallerosella calmariensis, and there's actually a second species, Gallerosella fusilla. They look almost identical. So in general, they were both released at the same time. And The larvae feed on bud, leaf, and stem tissue, and you can see in the lower right there that they can do quite a bit of damage. And then these larvae pupate in the soil or in the ground cover, in the leaf litter. And here's a little more example of the damage that they can cause. This is a picture of when we started the project. I think this was taken in 1997. And this is in July. These pictures were all taken in July. And again, these plants are about, 7 feet tall. And this is the railing you're looking at would be to look over into the water. So there isn't water there. And then I took this picture about 2 years later after we made our releases. So this was in July, and so there were no flowers. This was complete defoliation in a couple of years. After that, things kind of, sort of sorted out, balanced out a little bit. So that picture, it's a different view, but it's the same wetland in the upper left. Was about 1996 or 97, I think maybe that picture was taken. And then in the middle, 99, oh yeah, here it is, 98. I'll need to fix those numbers. But then we start getting where the plants were being impacted by the defoliation, and they were much reduced. So the bottom left photo, those plants are only about 3 feet tall, and they're very branched to the sides. And then you start to see some of these other native plants coming in. So the center bottom photo shows things like arrow arum and marsh marigold and things like that coming back. And the 2004 picture is sort of the peak of where we were seeing this. And what ended up happening was that the waterway was completely opened up, and that has never changed. What has changed, though, is over 20 years, some of the purple loosestrife has had a comeback. And then the beetles have a comeback, and we've been doing the dance of sort of going in an up and down cyclical fashion here. But still, the people at the zoo are generally pretty happy with this. And this shows some of those native plants that were established. The arrow arum and the swamp rose mallow, and probably the iris were already there. The elderberry and the arrowwood viburnum, I think the zoo staff planted those because they were trying to encourage native plants, but they've been able to grow. And we brought this to additional sites in Rhode Island, along rivers and ponds, and it has been considered a successful project, though it's not successful everywhere, and people are working on that. And with the Galler cell that we worked with, the idea was that we would have two generations, and it seems that in some places we do have two generations and we get the impact of that. And in some, they're only seeing one. And that has a lot to do with photoperiod. So now I want to go on to the one that we're currently involved in and that we started from the very beginning. This is the plant swallow-wort. And it's black swallow-wort in Rhode Island. There's two species that are invasive in the Northeast. And in Rhode Island, we primarily have the black swallow-wort. This is in a pasture. This is a pasture also. This one is now mowing more regularly, so it doesn't look quite this bad, but this was sort of when we started the work here, what it looked like. It's related to milkweeds, and so it has a pod very similar. I don't know exactly the number of seeds that come from what's one plant, what you'd call one plant, but it's very productive in terms of seeds. And it's also windborne, just like the milkweed. So that, kind of leads for quite a bit of seed dispersal. And then again, it has a very strong root crown and is a perennial. So it can spread that way as well. As I said, we have two non-native swallowworts. The one on the left is what we have in Rhode Island, black swallowwort. I use Vincitoxicum nigrum, which is the scientific name used in Europe. You will see in some USDA publications, many people still use Cynanchum louisii. And then pale swallowwort is Vincitoxicum rosicum. And if you notice, one of the obvious differences is the flowers. The black swallowwort has a dark pink flower, and sometimes it really does look almost black. It's like a dark purple. This picture doesn't show that quite so much. And then the pale one is more of a pale pink. And they are both native to Europe. So swallowworts, I already said they're in the milkweed family, Apocynaceae, and they're a perennial vining growth habit. They have windblown seeds. They can shade out native plants and threaten endangered species. And the monoculture seem to, you know, impact community composition. One of the kind of novel things about this plant is that it is toxic to livestock. So goats have been attempted to be used, you know, for grazing, and goats know better. They don't eat it. They'll eat all around it. We had a graduate student who did some work with the fact that we were finding monarch butterflies laying eggs on the undersides of swallowwort leaves. And so monarchs already have so many things, you know, working against them. We actually tried to do a little bit of feeding monarchs' diet and incorporating swallowwort into it to see if we could kind of increase their ability to feed on swallowwort and maybe use them as biocontrol. But what actually happens is the female thinks it's okay to lay the eggs on it, but when the eggs hatch and the larvae start to feed, they die. So it is toxic to them as well. So one of the you know, researchers who looked at this actually didn't think there was competition. It's possible in some places this research has been done on the pale swallowwort, and so there may be a bit of a difference in the chemistry between them. That's one of the things that we're looking at a little bit. But the kind of summary was that swallowwort also has a direct or I guess more indirect impact by competing with milkweeds. So in a pasture, instead of there being milkweeds many times, you know, it's a monoculture of swallowwort. So the swallowwort biocontrol process actually started in 2005 when we took on a graduate student, Aaron Weed. And in 2006, he began the classical biological control process of foreign exploration, going to Europe where the swallowworts are native and looking for insects that feed on it there. And he found a total of 5 insects. Two of them were beetles, one was a fly, actually a seed predator, a seed feeder. And then 2 were these 2 moths that you see here, Hypena opulenta, which I've decided I need to get a common name for, and Abrastella asclepiatus. And with both of them, we did the research here at the University of Rhode Island and in the quarantine lab, looking at the host range testing. Here's Hypena, a little bit of, it's actually, I haven't changed this slide, it's in the family Arebidae. It was Noctuidae, and it was found in Ukraine and Turkey. And until 2006, when Aaron Weed collected this, the caterpillar of this moth feeding on swallowworts, the host plant was unknown until that time. So the biology, you know, the whole life cycle, at about 20 degrees C, it'll take 5 to 6 weeks. So sometimes, you know, in the middle of the summer, you know, a generation might go through in about 4 to 5 weeks. The caterpillar you see in the middle, that's a 5th instar. It hatches, goes through those 5 different stages, and overwinters as a pupa in the leaf litter. You can have multiple generations a year, again, depending on where you are and what the temperature and photo period is. Our host specificity starts with coming up with a list of plants. So what plants, you know, do you need to test to go through this process? And you usually get help from other botanists, other researchers in the, you know, who would be interested in this. We ended up testing 79 species, and it was approved by a group called TAG, or the Technical Advisory Group, which is made up of people from a number of different agencies, tribal groups, fish and wildlife, also members from Canada and Mexico, since it's a North American group. And we tested 48 species from the family Apocynaceae, because that was the one that we were most, you know, concerned about, because of its importance, but also because of its close, you know, taxonomic relatedness to the swallowworts. And then we included some groups that had close relationships to the insects. So for example, the beetle Chrysalina that we were testing fed on some plants from Artemisia or the mugworts. And Abrascula and Hypena, other related species, fed on some of the horse nettles, plants like that. So we did actually have to grow horse nettles in the greenhouse for a little while. And so the summary of this host range work was that Hypena opulenta, which we were focusing on first, its larval host range is restricted to the genus Vincitoxicum. And so in North America, all we have are the two invasive weeds, the black and the pale swallower. And it can have multiple generations per year, which is helpful both in doing research in the lab and also in building up a field population. The larvae will target young foliage preferentially. And the two weeds, you know, the insect has similar development. It's effective on both, and it has a higher reproductive output. So the regulatory issues that are involved in classical biological control, one of the things that many people are asking right about at this moment is, you know, well, why would you bring something in, and what are the things we have to worry about bringing an insect in? You know, we're not happy having this invasive plant, but what do we do to protect ourselves from an insect that might cause some trouble of its own? So you're working kind of under the Plant Protection Act, and the biological control agent must not be a plant pest. And so if it only feeds on swallowwort, it's not considered a plant pest. But if it were to feed on milkweed, it certainly would be. The National Environmental Protection Act, it can't cause any risk to the environment. And then the Endangered Species Act, or any risk to a threatened or endangered species. And we learned in the process of running through our permit for swallowwort that there's a list of 1,590 endangered species. And it is very difficult to prove that a particular insect will have no impact. Some of these are birds, bats, reptiles, all kinds of things. But that those are the regulatory issues that are brought into play when you're talking about bringing in a biocontrol agent. So I had mentioned the technical advisory group. It's an outside group of experts who are helping to determine, you know, the danger of the plant pest dissemination into the United States. And so they're addressing the Endangered Species Act. And so they do things like advise us on our host specificity test plant list. And then also when we're done with the data, they review the data and they make a recommendation to the USDA about whether a permit should be given or not. And so the mission of TAG is to facilitate the biocontrol of weeds, but while protecting considerations of non-target impacts and conflicts of interest. Let's see. So when TAG approved our petition in the fall of 2013, Canada was able to get a permit almost immediately, about 2 weeks later. And so they made a fall release of some Hypena up in Canada, which did not appear to be successful. They weren't able to confirm overwintering, but they made the first large release in the summer of 2014. And in Canada, their primary swallowwort there is the pale swallowwort, and they call it dog strangling vine, or DSV. And it tends to grow in kind of shaded areas like this one you see here. I think they also have some in pastures. But one of the things that they found, and we've been seeing since, is that once there's some feeding damage, if you look at the picture on the right in this slide, some of the plants in the upper part of the picture, you see dark green leaves, which is what swallowworts usually are. And the lower right, you see some holes and also some lighter green color of the leaves. And so that seems to be what happens with feeding damage. It doesn't just remove the amount that the insect eats, but it seems to change the chemistry of the plant as it's maybe trying to defend itself, and the plants go into a bit of senescence. So we did receive our permit in 2017 for the United States. And prior to that, we had been working in a number of areas to get prepared for releases, to be doing some pre-release monitoring. And one of the things that we wanted to clarify, so in Ukraine, where Hypena opulenta was collected, it was collected from a shady area. And our main issue with swallow-wort seems to be in pastures. So we were a bit worried that the insect wouldn't be effective in open areas. So our first releases, we wanted to test that. We wanted to look in shady and sunny areas. And then Nishan Island in Massachusetts, where we chose to set up one of these experiments, also we had both pale and black swallow-wort. So we could test two species and we could test two different habitats. I had lots of help on all of these projects. These are some of my students. Here's a picture of one of the sites on Nishan with a cage in the shade and a cage in the sun. And we used the cage primarily to be able to kind of keep track. If we had our, at this point, we were releasing larvae into the cage. And when they pupated and became adults, we didn't want them to fly away. That's the thing about working with a moth. They can go pretty far, and it would be a little harder if they ended up on the mainland to decide, you know, where they were. So we wanted to, it's not considered a cage release, because we are planning on removing the cage, but we started out in the cage to be able to have a better shot at keeping track of the data. So we also set up a paired shade and sun release in Charlestown. And this one ended up sort of turning into three different situations, because we found that we had chosen our sun site in sort of a partly shaded area. So we picked a full sun, part shade, and a complete shade there. So this was, Yeah, so the results of the 2017, we got the permit in August. And so we just made small releases to see if we could have successful overwintering. And in Charlestown at this site, in the shade cage, we had one moth emerge the following June, on June 1st. And so that's been helpful for having a bit of timing, but otherwise we would have to say that the overwintering was not successful. One of the things that is true about this insect, though, especially we notice it in the lab, is that a certain percentage of pupae do not emerge within 1 year. They actually will emerge the next year. So there is a possibility that the timing of our release wasn't correct, and that some maybe would emerge in following years. So to show you a little bit about what the damage looks like, on the left are the smaller stages of larvae, like the firsts and seconds. And the feeding they do is like window painting. You can still sort of see some of the leaf tissue. They don't eat it all the way through. And then the larger ones will take the chunks out of the leaves. And you'll see lots of frass, which is the insect name, entomologist name for insect poop. So the graph down below just shows you that we looked at the full sun, the part sun, and the shade in the South Farm Preserve in Charlestown, Rhode Island. And the shade is the black line, part sun is the blue, and the full sun is red. And so what we're measuring here is the percentage of leaves that had some feeding damage on them. And this was over a period from late July to early September. And the shaded area with the black line, we had much more feeding damage. The larvae did much better. And the full sun, really, they did terribly. So the information we had gotten by where we collected the insects, you know, definitely said something about how they handled. Now, this is the 2018 releases, and one of the things I have to throw in here about 2018 was that if you look at the records, it was the hottest and most humid summer that we had, you know, in recent history. So I think it was not a good one to release these larvae and test this out. This is also 2018. And here's where we're just looking at the number of larvae that we were able to see in the cage. And this first one is the full sun. The numbers are fairly low. If you go to the part sun, we had an increased number of larvae found, and we got the highest numbers from the shade again. So when we took this information and we moved forward to 2019, we decided to release adults instead of larvae, thinking that we may have a better shot of you know, each female can lay a couple of hundred eggs, and so we might be able to get a lot in a cage without risking the high mortality of larvae right away. I just threw this in. This has something to do with the 2018 year being so hot and humid. Who likes hot and humid weather, especially fungi do? And so we actually had a dieback of our swallow-wort. You can see the healthy looking plants there are milkweeds, and all the black stems you see are swallow-worts that look like the pictures on the bottom. The upper surface has the black leaf spots, and the undersurface was loaded with this white fungus. So it kind of interfered in our ability to feed some of the larvae that we were, you know, cutting plants from the field. But it also appears as a potential for having an impact on swallow-wort in the future. So we're working with a plant pathologist to follow this up. So in 2019, we changed a couple of things. We released adults inside the cage instead of larvae. We started earlier. We started in very early June instead of July. And after about 3 weeks, we removed the cages so that the larvae could move out into the surrounding areas. And so we had additional sites as well. So Connecticut, Rhode Island, and Massachusetts. And basically all of them did very well. The one in Charlestown actually seemed to do the least well. And the only thing we can think of is we had a very shady spot, probably the darkest of all the spots. And the temperature was much lower and the amount of sunlight was much lower. And so we may have gone a little too far with that one. But in other cases, we had up to potentially 100% defoliation. And once we removed the cage, we continued to monitor for a few weeks afterwards to see that the larvae, you know, they'd moved about 4 meters away from the cage. The answer as to how successful this was is going to depend a lot on if these were able to overwinter and if we can find them again in the spring. So a complicating factor in terms of one of the things we'd liked about Hypena opulenta was that it was an insect that we could get a couple of generations from. And we didn't see that after the 2019 release. And Rob Bircher from Canada has been making, continued making releases since 2014 and has been researching a lot of areas associated with this insect. And one of the things that one of his students worked on is the photo period and at what shorter day length causes the larvae to go into diapause, overwintering diapause. And it turns out it's 15 hours. So when we've been doing rearing in the lab, we've been knocking them down to 12 hours to make sure they go to diapause. But they go into diapause anything less than 15 hours. And so one of my students put together this little diagram because she'd worked on the releases. So the names there are just all the different sites, but it shows where we started releasing somewhere in June and up to even July in some cases. And then the point in mid-July where really the larvae would have to be, earlier than the, say, third instar so that they could go into diapause. So anyway, if you're not as familiar with larvae, it may sound a little bit confusing, but the gist is we have to go even earlier. We may have to release in about mid-May if we want to get two generations. So we're learning a lot. This is what the inside of the cage looks like. And one of our release sites was the Arnold Arboretum, and they had asked us to hold a tree mob. And I thought, what is a tree mob? But it's, I think, you know, almost everything at the Arboretum, as you could guess, is a tree. And so people stand around a tree and learn about, you know, from an expert, something about the tree. So in this case, this is Lexi Johnson, the student who worked on this with me, and she's telling them about our releases and how it's supposed to help control the swallow-wort there. And the nice thing is the timing was perfect. They were able to look in that cage and see all that defoliation and see larvae crawling everywhere wanting more plants. So when we were done speaking here, we removed the cage and we let the larvae go free. This is a beautiful place in Jamestown, Rhode Island, right by the Jamestown Bridge. And this just shows again the damage and the shady setting that we chose for a release. And 2019, we saw this disease again, so we certainly are interested. It didn't seem to kill plants, at least not at the same site. But one of the differences that I noted was that in 2018, when the disease killed a lot of plants, they had mowed in July or August, and there were small seedlings that were hit and killed by this fungus. And in this case, you know, this year they just let them grow until, I think maybe they mowed in late September, early October. So this is something we plan to continue. So the lessons learned so far in these releases, we had expected, you know, Hypena maybe to do better in the shade than the sun, but these releases certainly confirmed that. We do have one data point for phenology, June 1st for emergence of overwintering adults. We're hoping we're going to get more data on that this spring. Adult releases certainly were more successful, again, partly because it was earlier. We didn't have quite as hot and humid as summer, but I also just think that the larval mortality is fairly high, and so we ended up with, you know, quite a few more larvae by releasing adults. The larvae dispersed well onto new foliage, and we do think that based on the photoperiod information, earlier adult releases will improve that chance of second generation. Thank you. I have many students who worked on this project and funding from the USDA, and I'm going to stop here for a bit in case there are any questions.
Oh, awesome. That's really cool. I have a couple of questions for you.
Okay.
Well, maybe we can talk generally about, I thought what you had to say about all the regulatory aspects did a pretty good job of explaining, you know, we're not just going willy-nilly and releasing these, making sure that these insects are doing their job and not, you know, doing our best to find out what surprises we might encounter. I did have somebody kind of, you know, ask, do you have any concerns with the regulations from the federal, with changes in administration? Like, who's making the decisions on this, and did they change over time?
So that's a really good question, and it did change a bit. That's one of the reasons, actually, why we had difficulty. I didn't highlight that too much, but it took about 5 years for us to go through the whole permitting process, and that's after the research was done. And usually it only takes maybe 2 or 3 years. And that was because U.S. Fish and Wildlife did change some of its policies. And that was, they had some change of personnel. I don't think it was specifically to do with the administration, because it actually started before 2016. So our difficulties were from around 2013 to 17. So I think it was just re-evaluating on the Fish and Wildlife, from their point of view, I think they re-evaluated their policies in regards to biological control and in regard to their protection of endangered species. And then, so they had someone new in that job who didn't have the experience with it. And so I think in the meantime, the USDA and the Fish and Wildlife worked together, and I think they may be sharing a person to handle that job, something like that. So that's pretty much what I know. I would say though that support for biocontrol, you know, does go up and down over the years. It can definitely vary.
So would you say it's fair to say that the decisions when it comes to regulating this are made by biologists?
Yes, they really are. I mean, so the technical advisory group is the generally their decision, that, and those are the scientists, those are the experts from Canada, from Mexico, and from the U.S. And they make the decision based on the science. After that, really the rest of the process comes down to the people who are willing or not willing to sign their name to the recommendation of the scientists. You know, I think that's sort of where it comes to.
Well, on the other side of the coin, and this maybe have more to do with changing administration, is the costs that are associated with these programs. So my question is kind of general, and maybe we can use black swallowwort as an example.
Okay.
Who is paying for these programs, if not, you know, federal grants? And do you have a sense of how big of an area you would need to attach to make it worth, like, a municipal organization paying for a release of these things down the road?
Whew. Those are hard questions.
You can speak generally if you don't have a joke.
No, I mean, they're very good questions. So most of our funding does come from the USDA, though we work on some of our biocontrol programs. One that we're working with now from with biocontrol of Phragmites is with Baron Blossy, and some of that funding comes from New York Department of Transportation, and some has come from Army Corps of Engineers. And so those are people that with Phragmites, you know, do a lot of need to spray for Phragmites, and so they're looking for an alternative to using pesticides. So, but with us, it's primarily been for our graduate students and for our research, it's the USDA. And in terms of municipalities, I guess, can you ask the question about the municipalities again?
I guess what I'm asking, like, I think you answered my question, which is, this is usually something that, you know, a big area, like a highway system would invest in, or, you know, the natural habitats you're talking about. That's something you do in your backyard.
Well, not this big investment. What does happen is, so with swallow-worts, we're now at the point where we're still, I call it, in the experimental phase. We're trying to work out the protocols of release, you know, where, when, the timing, the number, you know. When we have that more successful, then we can start making it available to more people. And actually, we have pulled in a lab, the New Jersey Philip Alampi lab, has started to rear Hypena opulenta. And so the idea is maybe 5 years from now, maybe only 3 years from now, a town in New Hampshire or Massachusetts might be able to purchase them from that lab and release them. But this kind of a project that takes 10, 12 years really does take something like a university or a USDA lab working on.
Okay, awesome. I think that gets to it. I mean, I think that the big picture is these are long-term projects. There usually takes some kind of investment from these institutions. It's not like you can go online and buy these, but you may be able to as like a town.
Yes. So the Gallerosella were available through the Philip Alampi lab, and the mile a minute weevil that I have up here, those are still available from the Philip Alampi lab. So if people have a problem with mile a minute, they can purchase those. It just takes a while to get to that point.
All right, well, let's see. I have a couple of general questions just to like walk through the timeline.
Sure.
Let's see, how am I going to put this? So do you want to use swallow-wort as an example? Because it seems like you're kind of right smack dab in the middle.
Sure.
Start to finish.
Okay.
You know, what's the timeline?
Oh, like? Sure. No, that's good. So we got a graduate student who came to work with us in 2005. Aaron Weed, and 2006, he went to Europe and did the foreign exploration. He finished his PhD in 2010, and that's about when we were finished with the host range testing. We had another master's student come along and finish the host range testing, and we submitted the petition in 2012, and we got our permit in 2017, and we've been making releases 2018 and 19. So we're on 14 years.
and about how many years more data do you feel like you'll need to collect to say, yep, this works?
Well, at least two or three, but it might be 5 or 10. I mean, the purple loosestrife example, if I only looked at the first 3 years, I would say, okay, great. You know, this is working so well. And then, you know, you kind of see that, okay, it's going to do some up and down movement back and forth between the plant having the upper hand or the insect having the upper hand. So unfortunately, it'd be best to monitor something for, you know, 10 years, but you usually don't get funding to go that long. It's difficult.
Are there any biological controls for bittersweet in the works?
No. No. Unfortunately, that is one that we contacted colleagues in China to sort of get that going, but I don't know. I think that maybe there aren't that many good candidates that someone is eager to start the process. Yeah, that would be a great one. The one that is coming soon, though, is Japanese knotweed. We are hoping to work with Fritzi Grevstad of she's out in Oregon, and she's waiting for her permit for a psyllid that feeds on knotweed, but that is one we will be assisting with.
Oh, those are so cute, those psyllids.
Yeah.
Well, those are all my questions for now. We
can, okay.
And we'll return to them, but take it.
Okay. Okay, so should I go on a little bit with Mile a Minute?
Yeah, I think so. We have another maybe 20 minutes.
Okay, yeah. This probably won't even take 20 minutes. So biological control of Mile a Minute is one that we just implemented in our area. Mile a Minute has been called the kudzu of the north because it does this. It's a vine, it's an annual vine, but it can pull down small trees. It certainly climbs up trees like this. And this is what it looks like in the winter. You can kind of see it sometimes driving by on the highway. Since it's an annual, it all dies back. It's from Japan, and it was introduced on nursery stock in the 1930s. It was in Pennsylvania and Maryland only until about 1980 when it started to spread north. They say it can grow about 6 inches a day, and we were growing it in the greenhouse at one point, and I believe it. You know, we had to prune, and you would just come back and see. And the seed is viable for 6 years in the seed bag, which is also, it makes it very difficult to control. Just a little bit on the identification of it. Once you know these few things, then you'll never really mistake it for anything else. People tend to confuse it with bindweeds. But one of the differences is this triangular leaf. Most bindweeds kind of have an arrow-shaped, and that also it has a saucer-shaped leaf at the nodes. They're called ochreas. So those little, and that's, its name is Persicaria. The genus is Persicaria, and the species is Perfoliatum. And so the Perfoliatum part is that the stem, you know, perforates this little leaf at the node. It also has small recurved spines or prickles along the stem, which makes it a tear thumb. And we have a native tear thumb, Persicaria sagittatus, something like that. And that one's arrow-shaped. And so that's the only thing that you could sort of maybe confuse the prickle part with. And then it has these green berries that have the seeds inside, and they turn blue when they're completely mature. So this picture here shows both the immature green and the mature blue seeds. So some of the negative impacts of invasive Mile a Minute, it establishes monocultures, it invades disturbed areas. As I said, it can pull down seedlings sometimes, and it does outcompete native or endangered plant species. There are mechanical methods. I mean, you can hand pull. I would only do it in the early spring, like this picture here, when they're very small. Once they get large, it's a pretty much of a mess. I have seen people do it, though. Very, very dedicated people. repeated mowing can prevent seed set. Grazing a sheep has been successful in small trials. And herbicides are helpful, but difficult for long-term management. And Mile a Minute does often grow along riparian areas near streams and rivers, so there you wouldn't want to be using herbicides. So the biological control program started with Judy Huff Goldstein in the picture on the right, and she has a book, This Biology and Biological Control of Mile a Minute Weed, is available online. And this work started, I guess the permit was issued in 2004, so it was started in the late 90s. And the insect that they worked with or completed all their research on was this Mile a Minute weevil. And the weevil is basically a beetle with a long snout. And this one feeds on the tips of Mile a Minute. And the adults kind of cause little holes of feeding, and then they lay eggs, which are pointed out by the arrows here. After the larvae hatch from those eggs, they climb down the stem, and they chew inside the stem, and so they can actually kill a stem. And here's a tip here to show some of that feeding and where the adult weevil is. if you look at this picture, if you look for the leaves with lots of holes, it's harder to tell that they're triangular shaped, but they are, but they have all that feeding. Then the ones that are arrow shaped, that's our native terethum. So I take this picture to show that once we had this in a site, we could easily tell that the host specificity trials were accurate, and that even though these are close relatives, the plants are close relatives, the weevil doesn't like our native terethum. Some of the summary results from the research that the Huff-Goldstein lab completed, and they had quite a few graduate students working on this, even though you say the immature seeds, the green ones, they can have viable seeds inside them. They also discovered that the weevils are much more effective at controlling the myelin in the sun rather than the shade. They don't find that they're likely to attack the canopy gaps, though, in a forested area. Plant competition was something they worked quite a bit with, and that's often called conservation biocontrol. That did improve the efficacy of the weevils to plant some native plants along with releasing weevils. And on years with a cool, wet spring, sometimes it results in a quickly increasing myelin cover and limits the weevil population growth. So those years you have decreased weevil efficacy. So here's just a graphic they have of that if you have direct feeding on developing seed can reduce the seed weight and viability, ability to germinate, where indirect feeding on the entire plant reduces the number of mature seeds and the number of seeds per cluster. This is a student who worked on planting native plants, and after 2 years, the weevil and the seed plots had twice as many native plant species as the no weevil seed control. This is just to show you the myelin-minute weed map on the left, and then where the weevils are on the right. So a good part of the distribution of the weed now has the weevil. Carol Chia has been doing this work in Connecticut and has released over 60,000 weevils in 27 towns in Connecticut. And basically now when somebody calls them to say they have a site with myelin in it, the weevils are already there. So they seem to be, and this, I didn't quite make this point, but with classical biological control, the goal is for a long-term management that is self-sustaining. And so that's really the goal of not needing to continually release, that they set up their own population and keep it going. So in Connecticut, they feel that they're established and surviving, but are not reducing myelin at most sites, especially large ones. And this is the case that in places like Connecticut and Rhode Island, I think that the myelin had a very big head start on the weevils. So we'll hopefully see it make further progress. They think the maturation of the fruit is delayed, maybe due to some of the weevil damage. We had release sites in Cranston, Rhode Island first, and then also East Greenwich. Places like power line cuts seem to have, along the roadsides. We even reared the weevils ourselves. This is where we had to grow these prickly plants and prune them back so that they had as many tips as possible for egg laying sites. We released over 82,000 weevils in Rhode Island. Many were received from the Philip Alampi lab, and the rest we reared. We've kept data on our first releases were in 2009, just one site, and up to about we got to quite a few sites, but this, I think I only have data for maybe five or six different sites here. It looks like we had the percent myelin-minute coverage, generally down in some sites, but not in every site, and a little better luck with the seed clusters. As I said, it seems to vary greatly from site to site, how effective it is. So we do have weevil populations at every release site, and it has reduced percent cover and seed most, or at least some of the sites. The large weevil releases can completely manage and actually wipe out a very small infestation of mile a minute. Most of our sites had been infested, we think, for about 6 years before we made the releases. And Ellen Link and Carol Chia helped keep me up to date on some of this information. And I just wanted to throw in that this is the little psyllid that we're going to be working with that we hope will help us with Japanese knotweed management. So that's what I have.
Oh, I have two more questions and then we'll wrap it up.
Okay.
Done within an hour. What happens when they run out of food to eat?
Ah, that's a very good question. So I think the purple loosestrife example is really good for that because I kind of saw it in play. So we had, you know, huge infestations of purple loosestrife in 1996, 97. We made releases 96, 97, 98. In 1999, we got a call from the zoo saying that our beetles were flying all over the zoo and annoying people. And we went there and they were flying around and all of the purple loosestrife was completely defoliated. There was nothing left. And a few steps away from that area, we found a few other plants with some feeding on them. And we were like, oh no, here's where we get our non-target effects. You know, one was a willow, one was a multiflora rose. And so there actually is a paper out on this about, they call it spillover effects. And so what we think, and there were beetles flying everywhere. One or two people asked for their money back because they thought it was so awful at the zoo. But there were so many and there was nothing else for them to eat. So they were tasting other plants. And so basically you get a few holes because they're tasting, but you know, nothing did much damage, certainly not very far away from that release site. And no eggs were laid, nothing like that. And nothing happened in future years. So it was just the sort of the amount we had released. And after a couple of years, it had built up so high that it completely defoliated everything. So then you follow through the next years. So the plants looked pretty terrible the next year, but there were still beetles, there were still plants. So, you know, the beetles then suffer because there's not enough food for them. And as they suffer, then the plant starts to do better. And so you just have one of those regular balance relationships between a herbivore and a plant. And that's really what the intent is. So when people, you know, if they're looking at, you know, if they're using herbicides or something, you know, they hope to not see the plant ever. But with some of these invasives, we don't think that's very likely. And so what biological control is really intended for is to provide the backup control. So even in your yard, if you want to yank them up or use an herbicide, but if there's an insect that's helping on the edges or on your neighbor's property or in the, you know, back lot near you, then they provide that background long-term management.
So those areas that don't get the love and care.
Yes. Yes.
Awesome. That's a good answer. I think we'll have enough time for this. About regionality. So it sounds like people who have the benefit of insect biocontrol with weeds is just because you're lucky enough to have an entomologist living in your region that studies that, correct? Do you have any comments or suggestions as to, basically I'm thinking about the scenario where I first contacted you, where, you know, somebody had a problem with a weed, they were reading about stuff that was going on out in Montana and wanted to apply that to their environment. Like, do you have any general comments about what you should avoid when making generalizations about things that from different regions?
Yes. No, that's a really good question because I have two examples of where we've sort of adapted research that was done in the West for a related problem in the East. Heather Fobert, who works with me, actually it was Watson Farm in Jamestown, where we also have swallow-wort problems, but they had quite a cypress spurge problem. And cypress spurge is related to leafy spurge. Leafy spurge's problem out west, and they developed a full biocontrol program for that. So Heather contacted the people out in the west, and they said that yes, the insects, leafy spurge and cypress spurge are close enough relatives that the insects that they had for their biocontrol program did work on both. And so she worked with him and made releases out here and followed them through. The thing that I would say is, even if you can purchase something online, I wouldn't do that without contacting someone in your state. You know, and someone in your state, either an entomologist from the university or someone from your Department of Agriculture, or somebody should be able to help you in making that contact and making sure that, yes, it's safe. Yes, you know, it's permitted. Yes, it's going to work. We have another one, knapweeds. There's spotted knapweed, diffuse knapweed out in the west, and again, a very well-developed biocontrol program. Here in the east, we have mainly black knapweed, though we're also getting some spotted, and we have some hybrids, which complicate the issue a little bit. But and so I contacted people from Oregon and was told that one weevil would be helpful, and possibly, you know, well, actually possibly a couple of weevils. And so we've started that project as well. But yes, it's pretty important to make sure, you know, what is your target and what is the best answer for it, and make sure you get the appropriate permits and all of that. And if you don't have someone in your state, sometimes, you know, with the swallow-wort, I'm working with people in other states as well. And I can potentially do that. And, you know, there might be somebody in Massachusetts who could help somebody in New Hampshire, or you in New Hampshire could help somebody, you know. So you want to contact your, local entomologists, even if they aren't necessarily biocontrol people to start with, they might be able to help.
Yeah, all of us entomologists know each other. All right, well, for the sake of time, let's wrap it up. But a couple questions about knotweed. What we can do is just put a link to more information about knotweed that I'm making. So if you can think of anything else to include that.
Okay, great.
Yeah, but otherwise, thank you so much.
This is sure. Cool. Sure. You're welcome. It was fun. Okay. Bye.
Bye.
Bye.